went to Seattle 2 weeks ago before the work in the coalition. I was in the first Starbucks shop in Seattle. And I
was there because 2 blocks away from the Starbucks shop, there is the office of Nordstrom. And in the office of Nordstrom, there was the meeting of Organic Exchange, the board meeting. And as ICO, we are in the board of Organic Exchange. Organic Exchange is a network of all the actors in the organic cotton chain. And it's rather unique, and it's, in my view, it's a marvelous example how to work in sustainable chain management. It's a network where all the actors from small farmers in developing countries until high fashion retail shops, certifiers, ginners, spinners, factories, industries, big industries in America, big industries in Taiwan, Japan, are working together, are meeting each other to look into the high transaction costs of the chain, the bottlenecks in the chains, the gaps in the chain. It's really a kind of open community, a lot by internet, but also by personal meetings. Where can we make the chain more effective of and efficient? And we as ICO are supporting that because we are supporting especially the farmer side of it. So I was there 2 blocks away from Starbucks in the Nordstrom office. And there a discussion was already on a very high and heat level because especially at the American companies, Nordstrom, Nike, under the canopy, CNA, were discussing the new, how do you say, challenges they experience at the moment. They have a lot of discussion about new fibers, polyester, organic, intelligent fibers, recycled fibers, and what to do with that. How could they source these new fibers? What are the possibilities? What is the carbon footprint? Where do they have to be? How do they can combine? And the meeting easily was taken over by the big companies. How could they do their sourcing, and how could they stabilize it towards the future? The discussion on cotton, organic cotton, was a little bit at the backside. The spinner of India, the American farmer, the factory owner of Turkey, they got silent. If the big market is in confusion and unsure, let they first make up their mind. Otherwise, we don't have any business at all anymore. So let's wait for the big companies. They have the demand. And then, talking amongst the companies, I, as an NGO maybe, I was the only one who could interrupt the discussion. And I asked just a simple question. But you, if you want to shift your materials, what about the rest of the cotton chain? All the investments we did, the farmers which are expanding their organic cotton fields, especially now in times of crisis and when the supply of the organic cotton is a problem, what about them? And if you want to focus now on cradle to cradle, on recycled materials, are we going to work with garbage people in the slums of Brazil in our network? It was silent. And they confessed that they totally had not thought about it. They were so involved in their own questions. And then the others got up. The Jenners, the factoryman, the farmer, the certifier, the cooperative, the financeman. Okay, your focus can be diversified. But there's still a lot to do in organic farming. We are still talking about 1% of the total market. Our mission at Corbis was organic cotton, the chain. And the discussion got a total different direction. The companies really listened. And they got into debate with the others, maybe for the first time that day. And the final resolution of the board were about organic cotton. And that's my observation, with all my respect. CSR is good. CSR is done by lots of good-willing people. CSR will help the world. But in general, the world of companies ends and begins at the factory gate. I think we have a very much more specific role in change, with chain actors, in partnerships, and really looking every time, every moment, what can we do? And we do it in several ways. We motivate companies. They ask for us to introduce more corporate social responsibility, to do ways of to find with them ways to do it. We link them to small producers to come. We link small producers to companies. We aid local farmers associations to organize themselves. We have studies on business models, on governance structures. We look commonly in the needs of infrastructure. We help in intercultural miscommunication. We look for supporting NGOs, business development service, financial services. And we cooperate with a lot on summarizing advice on sustainability. True partnerships benefit for all parties. Chain cooperation offers ICO and our local partners the opportunity to get better insight into the business side of the chain development. And for companies, it means that they can support small producers, secure their sourcing, and work together on lowering transaction cost, infrastructure, and a higher demand. Increased transparency in the chains make it possible for NGOs and producer organizations to make better balanced decisions about whether a partnership is indeed the best choice or other alternatives are more viable. But also it gives data which products in the market are asked for, what are the trends and developments in the market. Based on transparency, actors involved can spread their risks better. But a partnership is like a marriage. You need to work at it to make it a success, particularly since it's an intercultural marriage. After the wedding too, you need to work hard at learning to speak each other's language and seeing things through the other's eyes. How do we express the importance of the involvement of small producers in our jargon? How do we demonstrate the effects and the terms of conditions of supply imposed by the companies? How do we ensure that producers and the shop employee can really explain what the difference between purchase price and the price in the shops is based on? For many years, we are also working now with Albert Heijn. Albert Heijn wanted to procure sustainable fruit and vegetables from Africa and support also local community. Then they sought a cooperation with ICO. They want to put up a kind of foundation and support local community projects in the fields of housing, education, drinking water and healthcare. But we didn't want only social community projects. And nowadays, after some years, we really advise them in work on chain issues, on sustainability, production and selling, on the infrastructure necessary in their living environment of the producers, on the workers' representative bodies, on working policies on HIV/AIDS. We support Albert Heijn to ensure that the production of fruits and vegetables meet the basic standards that are accepted internationally. And small farmers, at least, are facilitated and supported so they can deliver their fruit and vegetables to African suppliers or Albert Heijn supply chains. ICO desires everyone involved in the transshipment of a product to earn a fair wage or receive a fair share, from producer to consumer. ICO believes that only by involving all stakeholders in such a product chain, it's possible to have fair trade throughout the entire sector. But it is, and it was, hard work. Cultural differences are sometimes too big. NGOs are not patient enough, and companies do still want to source cheaply, quickly, and scale up. And sometimes that's not possible. It takes time, and it needs time, and it needs support. We are supporting also the CSR organization, it's one of the biggest one in the world, of the Brazil employees. The Brazil VNO NCW. It's a very strong organization. It's really mainstream, and they're really having the big Brazil multinationals and national companies in it. They did their evaluation after 10 years and the strategic planning for the next 10 years. And one of their findings was that it's interesting, CSR, and it's interesting working with CEOs, but it's not enough. After 10 years working on culture, on behavior, on good-willing IDs of CSO, CFOs, we have to do more. It's not enough. We are making progress, but it's going too slowly. And now, after also a big fight with Petrobras, the big oil company of Brazil, who was not getting too fast enough in the eyes of the civil society and in the eyes of the government of Sao Paulo, Petrobras got out of Atos, but now they are in again, because again they are talking that really we have to change regulations and rules, we have to go faster. And that's what we need, that together with government and NGOs, branch organizations, support organizations, we look into the whole chain, that at the end, consumers and producers are benefiting from our sustainable efforts. Okay, let's go to the end, because I see Rob moving.
Maybe
one thing, who is financing all this work? No, the time invested by NGOs, by ICOR or others, who is paying for that? We can ask the companies to pay for it. We can ask for our services, and that is one of our problems. But companies at the beginning, because they are not used to NGO, they don't want to finance it. We can do it, and we make arrangements with them. We do it on loan basis. We do it on guarantee basis. We do it on a long-term basis. But also at the short term, you need some subsidy. It's a kind of public investment in the long term. It's one of our issues. We mainly quarrel with companies about it. But there are models to make it workable and to have a kind of combination of private and public funding in it. Okay, then being clear about mutual investments, mutual expectations, we will have a conclusion that we believe that if we really work in sustainable partnerships, focus on the long term, applying new business and governance models, developing new tools, supporting business development, supporting finance, that the debate is not business community or NGO, but the debate is, do we want fairness and sustainability in the whole chain, on the long term, and on in big scale? And that, I think, with global sustainability and fair trade is possible, but only if it tackles the whole sector and the entire chain. And then it's possible that we eat and we drink coffee in a sustainable and joyful way.